Hello, this is Socially Triggered. The goal of this video is to look at the power of words and to understand how context matters. Lately, our society seems to focus on the controlling of speech in an effort to control the way we think. Hate speech laws have this type of effect where people are afraid to say what they really think. Ironically, words are being used to silence people. Nowadays, if your views are slightly right of center, you can be slandered and destroyed by being called racist, sexist, or even a Nazi. For me, words have only as much power as we give them. This power usually comes from the context in which the words are used. However, there is one word which seems, regardless of the context when spoken, and especially when it's spoken by a white person, is considered toxic and unforgivable, actually. It is possibly the most powerful and the most negative word in the English language. And this word is the word nigger. I say it not because I particularly like the word, but because it has no power unless we give it power. And I give it no such power. In this video, I'll dismantle this word with a bit of help from some experts. My goal is if I can take the power away from this most powerful word, it will liberate people from all words. I am a free speech supporter. In a world where words are used to prevent or shut down speech, I want to regain our control over words. To see how this word has power over white people, I'd like you to watch this following interview.
But there's been a lot of controversy surrounding the usage of the N-word in this movie.
Nobody, none. The word would be...
Oh, I don't want to say it.
Why not?
I don't like to say it.
Have you ever said it?
No, sir.
Try it.
I don't like to say it.
Try it.
Really? Seriously?
We're not going to have this conversation unless you say it. You want to move on to another question?
Okay. Awesome. I don't want to say it.
Oh, come on.
Will you say it?
No, fuck no. That's not the same thing.
Why do you want me to say it?
They're going to bleep it when you say it on your show. Say it.
I can't say it. If I say it, this question it won't make air.
Okay, forget it.
Okay, I'll skip it. Sorry, guys. It was a good question.
This is the power this word has over people, and it needs to be dismantled. The interviewer couldn't even say the word. He said that if he even used the word, that the segment would not have been allowed to be aired. So why is this word so powerful, and what are the origins of this word? Originally, the word came from the Spanish and Portuguese. The word was negro, which means black. In English, it also gets its origin from the Latin word, which is niger, or black. Early English uses of the word nigger, it was considered a neutral word for a dark-skinned person. In English literature, the earliest known usage of the word was in 1574. The first time it was used negatively was 2 centuries later, in 1775, according to the Oxford English Dictionary. However, in the early 1800s, the word was used without any negative connotation in early American literature. Even Mark Twain's Huckleberry Finn, where it was used over 200 times, it was used to refer to Huck's slave Jim, where he was actually a sympathetic character. He was a good guy. It was not used negatively in any way. Though recent versions of the book have since removed it and replaced the word with slave. In the early 1900s, it completely fell out of favor, and it was replaced with terms colored or negro. Nigger and negro are actually the same words. It's just the English versus the Spanish versions of the word. So it was colored or negro that was used to for polite society to refer to black people. By 1960, though, the term black became the accepted term. For a better history of the word, I recommend reading Randall Kennedy's book, Nigger, The Strange Career of a Troublesome Word. It was a great book. The following video is a powerful story from Mr. Kennedy about how the word nigger became so powerful that its mere utterance can cause people to lose their job and destroy their reputation.
It's a story that comes to us from Michigan. There was a basketball coach, white basketball coach, who had a team. There were 4 black players on the team, 1 white player. The team was losing at halftime. The coach at halftime brings the team back into the locker room and he says, "Listen, fellas, we're losing. I need to talk with you very directly. Can I talk with you very directly?" They say, "Yes." He says, "Okay, now listen. I want to use the N-word in the way in which you use the word, the N-word. Can I do that? And they say yes. Now, what he meant by that, he didn't spell all this out, but what he meant by that was that in practice, the players would refer, would use the following term. They would say, you're playing like a nigger. And if you were playing like a nigger, that meant that you were playing with a lot of heart, a lot of concentration, a lot of verve. It was a compliment. So the coach wanted to use the term in that way. So the coach turns to the one white ball player and says, so-and-so here is playing like a nigger. Then he turns to one of the black players and says, so-and-so here is playing like a nigger. Then he turns to one of the other players and says, now so-and-so here is playing like a half nigger. And then he turns to the other two and he says, we're losing because you all are not playing like niggers at all. I need five niggers on the court. They go back out. They lose. But that's just the beginnings of the problem. That's just the beginning of the problem for this coach. To make a long story short, the coach loses his job. He's fired. There were various protests. He was suspended for a while. There was mandatory sensitivity training and various things. But ultimately, he was fired. This firing prompted two lawsuits. One lawsuit was initiated by the students on the team. One of the reasons why the coach was fired, this was a public university, one of the reasons why the coach was fired was because this coach had allegedly violated the school speech code. And the members of the team went into federal court and attacked the speech code on federal constitutional grounds. And they won. They succeeded in having the court strike down the speech code. The coach went into federal court to try to get his job back. He lost for reasons, legal reasons I needn't get into here. The question I ask in the book is, was it a good thing to fire the coach, given the circumstances, given what he was attempting to accomplish, given what the team thought he was attempting to accomplish? You know, what should he have been fired? My own sense of things was that no, he shouldn't have been fired. The athletic director told him that it had sort of gotten out on campus the nature of this locker room speech had gotten out on campus. It had become public knowledge. The athletic director said, you know, this was a very imprudent thing to do, much too susceptible to misunderstanding. So don't do it again. And the coach said, fine, I won't do it again. But as I've indicated, it didn't stop there. Ultimately, the coach was fired. My view, the coach ought not have been fired given the surrounding circumstances.
You would use the word bitch. The word bitch actually comes from the word for female dog. And by basically associating the female aspect with a dog, you've now made that woman feel less than a woman, and therefore you're really demeaning them. Well, that's how insults work. We create something that has an element of description that applies to the person that we're insulting, and we have an element that is negative, so you connect the two. Insults, though, have no power if they don't achieve this descriptive element. So somebody could call somebody a nigger without being racist, yet is using the negative meaning of the word to insult. This is because they aren't making an attack on all black people, but they are making an attempt to insult the one black person who they wish to insult. A good example of this separation between insulting the individual and connecting it to mean all of the people from a group can be seen in the way Chris Rock uses it in his famous niggers versus black people routine. Here's a clip of that routine.
Now we got a lot of things, a lot of racism going on in the world right now. Who's more racist, black people or white people? Black people, you know why? 'Cause we hate black people too. Everything white people don't like about black people really don't like about black people. There's some shit going on with black people right now. It's like a civil war going on with black people. And there's two sides. It's black people and there's niggas. Niggas have got to go. Every time black people want to have a good time, ignorant-ass niggas fuck it up. Can't do shit. Can't do shit without some ignorant-ass niggas fucking it up. Can't do nothing. Can't keep a disco open more than 3 weeks. Grand opening, grand closing. Can't go to a movie the first week and come out. Why? Because niggas are shooting at the screen. What kind of ignorant shit is that? Hey, that's a good movie. That's so good, I got to bust a cap in here. Hey, I love black people, but I hate niggas, boy. Oh, I hate niggas. Boy, I wish they let me join the Ku Klux Klan. Shit, I do a drive-by from here to Brooklyn. Niggas, man. You can't have shit when you're around niggas. You can't have shit. You can't have no big screen TV. You can have it, but you better move it in at 3 a.m. Painted white, hope niggas think it's a bassinet. Can't have shit in your house. Why? Because niggas will break in your house. Niggas will live next door to you, break in your house, and come over the next day and go, I heard you got robbed. Man, you know what the worst thing about niggas? Niggas always want some credit for some shit they supposed to do. For some shit they just supposed to do. A nigga will brag about some shit a normal man just does. A nigga will say some shit like, I take care of my kids. You supposed to, you dumb motherfucker. What are you talking about? What are you bragging about? What kind of ignorant shit is that? I ain't never been to jail. What, you want a cookie? You're not supposed to go to jail, you low expectation of a motherfucker. Fuck, man, I'm tired of this shit. You know what the worst thing about niggas? The worst thing about niggas? Niggas love to not know. Nothing make a nigga happier than not knowing the answer to your question. Just ask a nigga a question, any nigga. Hey, nigga, what's the capital of Zaire? I don't know that shit. Keeping it real. Niggas love to keep it real. Real dumb. Niggas hate knowledge. Shit. So I tell you, niggas are breaking your house. You want to save your money? Put it in your books. Because niggas don't read. Just put the money in the books. Shit, books are like kryptonite to a nigga. Here's a book. No! No! Not a book! No! No! Tired of this shit, man. Your kids can't fucking play nowhere. Every year the space gets smaller. Okay, you can go from that corner to that corner. Oh, you can go from that gate to that gate. By the time motherfuckers 10, he's just hopping in a circle like... I heard some song the other day. It's the first of the month. Niggas are singing welfare carol. Now they got some shit they're trying to get rid of welfare. So every time you see welfare in the news, they always show black people. Black people don't give a fuck about welfare. Niggas are shaking in their boots. Oh, they gonna take our shit. Shit, a black man that got 2 jobs, going to work every day, hacks a nigga on welfare. Like, nigga, get a job. I got 2, you can't get one? First of all, they try to make it look like, you know, there ain't even that many black people in the country, okay? Black people are 10% of the fucking population. Black people in New York, D.C., L.A., Chicago, Atlanta, like 10 places, okay? Okay? 10 places. Ain't no black people in Minnesota. So all you find, only black people in Minnesota is Prince and Kirby Puckett, okay? Shit, the whole rest of the country, the other 40 states, is filled up with broke-ass white people. Broke-ass, living in a trailer home, eating mayonnaise sandwiches, fucking their sister, listening to John Cougar Mellencamp records. And I see some black people looking at me, man, why you gotta say that? Why you gotta say that? It ain't us, it's the media. It ain't us, it's the media. The media has distorted our image to make us look bad. Why must you come down on us like that, brother? It ain't us, it's the media. Please cut the fucking shit, okay? 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 When I go to the money machine tonight, all right? I ain't looking over my back for the media. I'm looking for niggas. shit. Ted Koppel ain't never took shit from me. Niggas have. So you think I got three guns in my house because the media outside? Oh shit, Mike Wallace, run!
You'll notice there the clear distinction between the two groups. Niggas refers to the segment of black population that causes trouble. The same can be seen in swears directed at white people. Terms like white trash or rednecks refer to whites who are not good people or uneducated or poor. So when someone uses any of these words, we need to understand the context in which they are used. Insults only have as much power as we give them. If we allow words to cripple us, then we give those who use those words against us power over us. Remember, sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt me. Once we gain control over words, and instead of having them control us, we all benefit. We can't allow words to control us. We need to be able to see beyond the word and look at how it's used. And if it's used wrongly, if the context is bad, if it's racist or whatever, then, as Ben Shapiro would always say, I'll fight racism whenever I see it, and I'll fight it with you. That's the way we should all be about this. Most cases, it's just a word, and we shouldn't let those words have power over us. This is Socially Triggered. Please comment, like, and subscribe, and give me your feedback. I really need that feedback.